listening to Daybreak Africa on the Voice of America. My name is Jackson Bunganyi. The United Nations says that more than 130 people were killed in an attack on a Fulani village in central Mali on Saturday. Survivors of that attack accused traditional Dogon hunters of carrying out the deadly raid in a village of Ogosagu. A spokesperson for the UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres said that he was shocked and outraged by reports of the killings, and he called upon authorities in Mali to investigate and bring perpetrators to justice. Experts on the region say that attacks in this area are fueled by accusations of Fulani herders grazing cattle on Dogon land and disputes over access to land and water. But the presence of the jihadists in the region has further complicated the relationship between these two groups. And for context on the dynamics behind this conflict, I reached Corinne Dofka. She is the West Africa Director at Human Rights Watch. Corinne has covered this conflict extensively and joins me online from Washington, D.C.
Corinne, thank you for joining us today on Daybreak Africa. Can you start off by telling us what is the history of this conflict and explain to us some of the groups of people involved and the kind of disagreements that they have with each other?
Yes. Well, the area in which this massacre occurred, and to be clear, this is the latest in a cascade of massacres that have happened in this particular area, which is bordering bordering Burkina Faso. You have a number of different ethnic groups, but primarily you have the Fulani or Peul, which are largely herders, and then you have the Dogon, who are primarily engaged in cultivation. And so there have always been some tension between these two groups over access to land and water. But they have always been able to settle their differences through local reconciliation mechanisms. Since about 2015 or 2016, as armed Islamists began digging in and expanding in central Mali, and then later toward in 2016 down towards Burkina Faso. Mm-hmm. Now, the Islamists have concentrated their recruitment on the Fulani. They have tried to do this by exploiting grievances over corruption, over lack of justice, over banditry, and so on. So as the Islamists have attacked on occasion some key members of the Dogon community, the Dogon armed themselves and organized this self-defense group to defend their villages from the increasing presence and attacks by the armed Islamists.
Okay. So it is reported that the Dogon, in this instance, the Dogon attacked a Fulani village. Was this in retaliation of an earlier attack? Have there been recent reports of fighting in that area?
Yes, there have been. So for over a year, there has been a relentless tit-for-tat between armed Dogon and armed Peul or Fulani in that area. And last week, there was an incident in which we understand four Dogon were killed, probably by armed Islamists. A few weeks ago, there was an incident in which a young Dogon went missing. His family went looking for him. They found him dead. And as they were trying to bury him where they found him, an IED went off, exploded, and killed 17 members of that Dogon family. So the armed, and that is, allegedly involving or was allegedly planted by the armed Islamists. So there have absolutely been atrocities against the Dogon community. However, they have engaged in, this militia has engaged in reprisals that have killed dozens of Peul villagers. They have, in fact, engaged in collective punishment against entire Peul villages.
So it doesn't matter whether these villages or the people in these villages are either part of these jihadists operating in that region. They just kill wholesale whichever Fulani. They attack a village and everybody is killed.
That is, yes, that
so,
is correct.
So, like you said, there are jihadist elements operating in this region. How did they come to be in play, and how has their presence amplified this conflict?
Yeah, what has happened in central Mali since 2015-16, and then in Burkina Faso, and certainly along this area, which has been affected by by this violence, including that violence on Saturday, is a result of the insecurity which occurred in Mali in 2012 when Mali fell to separatist Tuaregs and armed Islamist groups in the north, and when the French-led intervention came in 2013 and tried to sweep away those armed Islamist groups. Some of them started moving south, and they started their recruitment and focusing their expansionist or localization efforts on the areas in central Mali and northern Burkina Faso, and again, concentrating their recruitment on the pole groups.
Talk to us, Corinne, about the culture of self-defense in this region and how that undermines the central government's ability to exercise some form of control over this conflict.
Many ethnic groups in Mali have had local self-defense groups. They also have a culture. The Dozo is a traditional organization that they say is based in ethos of protecting their family members in their villages, and it's grounded in mysticism, and it's grounded in respect for villagers. But this concept has been exploited by people who are arming them and engaging in not just defensive operations but offensive operations. And the big question mark here is the extent to which they're working with the state. Now, we have not been able to find the concrete evidence of that. Many people believe that the state has subcontracted some of their defense responsibilities to these groups. We have called for an investigation into that very thing because we have said repeatedly that it is the responsibility of the Malian state to ensure the security of their population, and it is their responsibility to protect all members of their population, regardless of their ethnic group, equally.
Now, you said that in the past these groups have been able to talk and where they stop fighting. How do the jihadists react when these two groups come to some form of truce? Usually.
Well, I've documented a dynamic in which the Islamists have in some ways appeared to undermine reconciliation when the different groups have arrived at it. I've documented this in a few different places after there have been informal peace treaties or negotiations which have brought a return of calm. Then you will have the Islamists target and kill an important member of the Dogon or the Bambara, for that matter, populations. And then that just sets the cycle going again.
It continues again. And finally,
yeah.
Corinne, do you know of any efforts by by international bodies like the UN or any local organizations, including the central government in Mali, to manage this conflict in ways that there are no more casualties?
Well, I think the Malian government has overemphasized reconciliation efforts over justice. And we believe that had they early on arrested and questioned and ensured justice for some of the earlier massacres that occurred even a year or 2 years ago, that we wouldn't have reached to this point. So we're concerned about that. Now, that said, they have today, to their credit, announced that they are disbanding this abusive militia group. That is a step in the right direction. But they absolutely have to ensure that the leaders of these organizations and, of course, those perpetrating violations against the Dogon are investigated and brought to justice, because otherwise this very deadly cycle of violence will not end.
Corinne, thank you very much for talking to us today.
Okay, thank you.
That was Corinne Dufka. She is the West Africa Director at Human Rights Watch. She joined me on the phone from Washington, D.C.